Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Osteology of the Skull. And in this part of our lecture, we'll talk about lateral aspect of the skull. This is a photo of actual skull. Here is color-coded picture in which we can see what bones constitute lateral aspect of the skull. So if we go from front to back, so we can see frontal bone, we can see parietal, we can see occipital bone, temporal, sphenoid, this is greater wing of sphenoid, zygomatic bone, barely we can see ethmoid, lacrimal, maxilla bone, nasal bone, and mandible. What are important features of a lateral aspect of the skull? We have to talk about a couple major features. They are temporal fossa above zygomatic arch with pterion in the floor of temporal fossa, zygomatic arch itself, and if we remove zygomatic arch and ramus of mandible, we will expose another important feature of lateral aspect of the skull, which is infratemporal fossa. Let's start with temporal fossa, which shaped like an oval. Inferior boundary of temporal fossa is zygomatic arch, its superior border, yeah, superior border of zygomatic arch. A zygomatic process of temporal bone continues into supramastoid crest, which continues into superior and inferior temporal lines. So you can see that superior temporal line forms superior boundary of temporal fossa. And anteriorly, temporal lines continue into zygomatic process of frontal bone, which continues into frontal process of zygomatic bone. So we ultimately went full circle or full oval. So those were boundaries of temporal fossa. You can find boundaries in this slide. Next, we should talk about floor and roof of temporal fossa. Floor of temporal fossa formed by four bones: frontal, parietal, temporal, and sphenoid. And at point of articulation, we have very interesting structure shaped like letter H, pterion. Opposite to floor, we have to have roof. Roof of temporal fossa is formed by temporal fascia, which originates from superior temporal line and inserts into superior margin of zygomatic arch. Content of temporal fossa. Why temporal fossa is so important that we have to talk about it. Content of temporal fossa is temporalis muscle. Under temporalis muscle, we have anterior and posterior deep temporal nerves, arteries, and veins. And over temporal fascia, which covers temporalis muscle from the outside, we will find superficial temporal artery, which is one of two terminal branches of external carotid, as well as superficial temporal vein, reticulotemporal nerve, and zygomaticotemporal nerve to innervate skin over the temple. Couple of words about pterion. As we said, it's a structure shaped as letter H at the articulation between four cranial bones: squama of frontal bone, parietal bone, squamous portion of temporal bone, and greater wing of sphenoid. In infants, this is location of anterolateral fontanel or sphenoid fontanel, and when it ossifies, we end up with pterion. Bones here are very thin. We can refer to pterion as the weakest part of the skull. So those bones are easy to fracture. And the problem with this location is the fact that immediately under pterion, we have trunk and branches of middle meningeal artery. So fracturing of bones in vicinity of pterion would lead to epidural hematoma. Next important anatomical landmark, which we have to talk about on the lateral aspect of the face, is zygomatic arch, formed by articulation between temporal process of zygomatic bone and zygomatic process of temporal bone. As we already said, temporal fascia, which originates from superior temporal line, attaches to superior border, superior margin of zygomatic arch. And masseter muscle, attaches to inferior surface of zygomatic arch. On the posterior inferior part of zygomatic process, we will find articular tubercle and condylar fossa or mandibular fossa, which participate in formation of temporomandibular joint. If we remove zygomatic arch and ramus of mandible, we expose another structure of lateral aspect of the skull, infratemporal fossa, which contains temporalis muscle, medial and lateral pterygoid muscles, which contains maxillary artery and its branches, as well as mandibular division of trigeminal nerve and its branches, and chorda tympani nerve. We will discuss infratemporal fossa in more details next week.
Thank you.